forever. And it is very important. And not sila, samadhi, panya, morality, concentration, and wisdom. No, they are not regarded as the essence of the Buddha's teaching. No, the most important teaching of the Buddha. So here and above, I told you, okay, the noble training of the morality, concentration, and wisdom. The aim is to develop morality, concentration, and wisdom together so that we can develop the highest wisdom. We call the four-part wisdom, the four-fruition wisdom, and Nibbana. And these nine dhammas, they are known as the noblest supramundane dhammas, because they can totally eliminate all defilements, all 10 defilements. So I describe 10 defilements here. They are the causes of all suffering and the causes of all evil actions. And they are the causes why people are not happy, and many of them committed suicide, and then why we don't get the world peace. So one is lopa or tanha, meaning greed, craving, and attachment. And the Buddha even described tanha, that is greed, craving, to be the cause, the noble truth of the cause of suffering. Because so long you have this tanha, you will be born again and again, giving rise to five aggregates, and which are really the noble truth of suffering, actually. And then dosa or patiga is anger, hatred, or evil, the most destructive element in the world, said the Buddha. And moha and or avijja, we translate it as ignorance and delusion, and they are actually the leader of these 10 defilements. Because of the ignorance that it produced on us, we are ignorant of the true nature of the existence, true nature of sense objects, and because of that, we have to suffer a lot of suffering. And mana is pride or conceit. And then we have the dhiti is the wrong view, and the vijikicca is skeptical doubt, and uddacca is restlessness of the mind, and tina is sloth or laziness that make us lazy, and ahiriga, moral shamelessness, not ashamed to perform evil actions, and anuttaba, moral fearlessness. And people are not afraid to perform evil actions because they are ignorant of the natural truths and the natural laws, especially the law of karma. They don't know that. Now we say defilements defy, debase, and burn the mind. They are the causes of all evil action and suffering in the world, and they have been growing and thriving in our minds, in the minds of all worldlings, since time immemorial. So these defilements, they exist in our minds in three layers. And you should also know about this. Anusya kilesa is latent defilements, that lie dormant in the bird, in the mind, since you are conceiving in the mother's womb. So when the rebirth consciousness arises, the defilement, they also come along as latent defilement. They still lie laden and they don't arise in the mind yet, but ready to arise in the mind when sense objects appear in the sense doors. And number two is Priyottana Kilesa, moderate defilement that have arisen in the mind and started to agitate and inflect the mind as hindrances. No? Hindrances. No? In Pali we call Nivaranas, they hinder, obstruct the arising of moral minds and the arising of meritorious deeds and the arising of Jhana, Megha and Phala. And they are really our internal enemies. And then number three is we take a makilesa. So now when these moderate defilement, if you cannot control them, they become inflated and gross, and then you will perform many evil actions. And they would these evil evil actions will develop billions of bad karmas that we condition the people, most of the people, to be born in the woeful abodes when they die. So defilements are growing and thriving and flourishing in our minds, like a very huge kilesa tree. So defilement in Pali we call kilesa, as they burn, defy and burn the mind. So if we want to cut down a very big tree, we have to cut the branches first, then cut the stem of the tree, and then dig out the roots and burn them so that the tree will never grow again. So similarly, to eliminate all defilements from our mind totally, we need to develop pure morality to subdue gross defilements. Just like cutting the branches of the big tree. Then we have to develop the right concentration to attain the purity of the mind, free from those moderate defilements, including the hindrances that we say our great internal enemies, the hindrances. Okay, and then after you dig out the roots of the tree, after cutting the stem of the tree, then we dig out the roots of the tree and burn it so that the tree will never arise again. So in the same way, we have to undertake the Noble Threefold Training to eliminate all kilesa from our mind. So we go to page one again. So now the Samatha Bhavana, tranquility meditation. So the object of this, the tranquility meditation is to accomplish the training of concentration, to accomplish the training of concentration, to purify the mind from the hindrances, nivaranas, and also other defilements, kilesa, to develop the mind to the right concentration and to attain the purity of the mind, citta visuddhi. This is the objective of undertaking the training of the concentration. And the objective of vipassana meditation is to accomplish the training of wisdom to develop 10 insight knowledges, we call vipassana jnanas. And the four-part wisdom, Megha Jnanas, to purify the mind totally from all defilements, including latent defilements, to get enlightened to the Four Noble Truths, and to become noble person arrears who can enjoy the eternal peace and the supreme happiness of Nibbana forever. And actually, when you become noble person, you attain the highest attainment and the best attainment in life. And the higher teachings of the omniscient Buddha is the Noble Eightfold Path. So we begin with the training of morality. Okay, we go to the next again. So, page two, at the bottom. So, no. So before we do that, we have to do number one. No? And the Buddha, no, the in the Ratha Nida Sutta, and also in Visuddhi Magga. No? So the Buddha described there are seven steps to purify the mind totally. And then we have not to begin with undertaking pure morality. So where we have pure morality? Here, I think. Page two. I'm undertaking Samatha meditation. So, not the, okay. So, in the, not the, undertaking the training of morality. So, for human being, for lay person, when we undertake meditation, we have to observe 8 noble precepts. Because we have to not to abstain from the sensual pleasure also. Otherwise you cannot develop not the concentration. And then for the monks, the Buddhas taught them to develop the full morality to purify the morality totally. And it consists the Patimokkha Samara Sila. So the monks they have observed 227 the rules and disciplines in brief, and more than 90,000 rules actually in the broad method. Observing that to protect themselves from being born in the Vipassana boat. And for us, if we can take even Panja Sila, 5 precepts. And then if we can take 8 precepts, so it is just like the Patimokkha Samara Sila, it will protect us from being born in the Vipo state. And the second morality is called mindfulness of the 6 sense objects. It is called Indriya Samara Sila. We have to be mindful of the 6 sense door, the eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue. Sense objects are appearing all the time, and then we are reacting to these sense objects. So in reacting, we have to be mindful not to develop immoral mind and not to develop those defilements to arise in the mind. And then number 3 is it is called Pachya Sannisiddha Sila, in undertaking the full requisites for the monks and for us. For the essential, the food essential, clothes, etc., when we take them, we always have to reflect with wisdom so that that defilement do not arise in our mind. And then number 4 is the pure morality. We have to also lead pure morality. And then after we undertake to observe the moral precept, and if we are undertaking the meditation, then our morality will be very, very pure. And be careful, only if you can maintain pure morality, you will be able to develop the right concentration. No, after every meditation, if you keep on talking with each other, you will never develop the right concentration, we say. So, the Buddha, in the Samatha Sutta, he very often persuaded the monks to develop the right concentration. She says, O monks, try to undertake tranquility meditation to develop the right concentration. Only if you attain the right concentration, you will attain yatha bhuta jnana, the wisdom that can understand correctly all ultimate realities and the four noble truths. No, so it is very important to develop the right concentration. And the eightfold noble path, the eighth factor of the path is called the right concentration. No, not it is the ordinary concentration. So in the very important the Mahasatipatthana Sutta, the Buddha also said that the right concentration is a concentration that associates with the four rupa vachara kusala chaita. So the best way if we can develop the four rupa vachara kusala chaita, it will be the best. And then if you say, can we undertake the Vipassana meditation without developing the jhana? Yes, the also like in Visuddhi Magga and also in the Sutta, the Buddha said if you can correctly develop the neighborhood concentration of the first jhana, you shall be able to undertake meditation, Vipassana meditation. But very, very difficult. Because the neighborhood concentration, and some people, they even make it even worse actually. So when they saw the teaching of the Buddha in the Sutta, when we are undertaking Vipassana meditation, the concentration is khanika smati, he said. Khanika means momentary. So momentary, the concentration, they say. So they don't develop even the neighborhood concentration. The Buddha said, if you truly attain the neighborhood concentration, your mind becomes pure. That is the second stage, actually. The first stage is the purity of morality. And the second stage is, we have to develop the purity of the mind. The purity of the mind can be attained only if you can drive away all those hindrances that arise in the mind. The moderate defilement that arise in the mind. So all these should be pure from the mind. And when your mind becomes pure, it becomes very, very powerful. Very powerful. So even if you attain the neighborhood concentration correctly, you will enjoy the bliss, the meditation bliss, much greater than sensual pleasure. And then it will radiate very bright, penetrative light. With close eye, you can see all living beings, all the objects, better than with your open eye, actually. And then with close eye also, you can see penetratively all your internal organs. Your heart, your liver, and then all your intestine, etc. So, and then you can even see all over Kuala Lumpur. You can look at your house, what your family are doing. So they have such an ability. But even that, the Buddha, he said, the neighborhood concentration to the first jhana is still not very stable. It is just like a child who starts to walk. So this child will fall down very often. You have to prop him up to walk. The same thing if you use the neighborhood concentration, the concentration will go down very often. And then you have to develop the concentration again and again. And by meditation, if your effort becomes slackened, then you will fall into the buinga state. That means only buinga chitta, life continuum consciousness, keep arising. And that consciousness, the consciousness that arises when you are asleep. So when that life continuum consciousness is arising, actually you are sleeping. Why you are meditating, you see, you don't know anything. You don't know anything. So some people ask me, teacher, after I meditate something, I don't know anything. No, he said, is that Nibbana? So, can just study meditation, how can you attain the Nibbana? So I said, there is not Nibbana, you are asleep. No, you are falling asleep actually. No? And so, no, if you are only developing concentration, very little concentration, you cannot see the ultimate mentality, materiality. No, they are, no, when we come to Vipassana, we have to see totally all, no, the ultimate mentality, the arising and perishing, all, no, rapidly. And remember all the eight factors of the, no, the Eightfold Noble Path are ultimate mentalities. Ultimate mentalities. And all defilements are ultimate mentalities. And we have to develop, no, the, our good, no, the good ultimate mentalities. No? No, to develop the highest wisdom and to eliminate all those, no, the defilements. Okay, no. So now if you can develop, no, the jhana, it's much better. So only those people, no, who are, no, who are not, no, no, the their wisdom are not very, very bright, they cannot develop the jhana by any way. Only then, no, they should develop, they undertake Vipassana by the neighborhood concentration. Now, no, the popular the tranquility meditation, almost in all meditation centers nowadays, is, no, mindfulness of breathing, we call anapanasati. So, it is, no, the foremost meditation subject among the 40 meditation subject of Samatha meditation taught by the Buddha. And the Buddha himself used this mindfulness of breathing. No? So, no, most of the time, no, in his meditation also. So, we should, no, I described just the outlines here. And then, no, I have written a book already, no, it is called Breakthrough in Samatha Meditation and Vipassana Meditation, no, together with the Pauk Shadow, no, I have written the book. So I cannot bring very many much, and I have, no, also distributed a little in Thai, in Penang and the, no, in Malacca. So I have only for about 40 books here. So, no, we'll give the 10 copies to the executive committees, and then the remaining we have to make, you know, to draw the lot. That who will get it? Who will get it? No. So in that I actually described, you know, fully, comprehensively, now the about the Samatha meditation and Vipassana meditation. No, you can read in detail, and I also described, you know, the full the meditation on this anapanasati. So, you know, when we undertake the Samatha meditation, so the best position is, you know, the sitting position is the best. So even in sitting, you know, it's the, you know, if you can cross-legged sitting is the best actually. You know? So you sit comfortably, whatever is comfortable to you. No, even if you cannot do cross-legged, you can even sit on a chair, it's all right. No, on a cushion, it's all right. No, what is important is to be mindful of the breath, not the in-breath and the out-breath. And then, no, we no, so we no, the advice to keep our body erect, no, while we are meditating. No? So if you are, no, you are doing like that, you can't meditate very long. Only you may erect like that, you can breathe fully, and you can, no, you can also, no, meditate very well. No? And then, no, relax yourself, and then try to determine how to put your legs, not your hand. Otherwise, no, you may be moving your hand all the time. No, so during the meditation, no movement. No, the best is no movement. No movement of the hands and the legs, etc. So, no, if you like the Buddha's way, no, so just try to put right hand on the left hand, and put on the thigh, and then relax your body, and then close your eyes. Don't meditate with open eyes. So if you open your eye, you will be looking here and there. You cannot concentrate. And then you breathe normally, we say. Now you breathe normally, and you should focus your attention on the nostrils and the upper lip. Just here. So you know you are breathing in, and you breathe out. You breathe in, you breathe out. And then while you are breathing in, you are breathing out. We say, if your mind is wandering, you cannot control very well. So you can use the counting method. The counting method is very, very good. So we ask you. So mindful of the in-breath and the out-breath is the first step. And you can use the counting method to control the restless and wandering mind. So counting is very easy while you are meditating. You breathe in, breathe out. Mentally, you just note one. Breathe in, breathe out, two. Breathe in, breathe out, three. Breathe in, breathe out, four. Breathe in, breathe out, five. You should count at least five. And not more than 10, they say. So at the beginning, you can count up to five if you want to. But if you can also count up to eight. So in reverence to the Eightfold Noble Path. So we count to eight, one to eight, one to eight, one to eight. And you will find that by counting, you can control very well. Your mind will not wander away. And then while you are trying to be, you have to be aware of your breath, we say. The anapana in Pali means in-breath and out-breath. So you have, this is your meditation object. You have to to know this in-breath and out-breath all the time. If you are taking other places, focus on breath, there is no longer anapana state. If it is not anapana state, you cannot develop the full rupa jhana. You cannot develop. So only if you take notice and mindful of the breath, then you can develop the four rupa jhanas as taught by the Buddha. So while you are meditating, you have to be aware of around here, because the in-breath and the out-breath, they touch around here. They touch around here. So you have to know the touch of the in-breath and the out-breath. And according to my experience, whichever point you focus at, so it's better to focus at the nostril or if possible, at the upper lip, just in front of the nostril. If you just focus, you are there. Very soon, the touch will become very distinct, very distinct. While you are breathing out, we are it is just like a breeze, blowing like a breeze. So if you put your hand here, you can feel the touch on the hand. So the same thing, the touch is on the upper lip or in the tip of the nose or in the nostril. So in the nostril, wherever you like, on the right or on the left, one place, just focus on there, then it will become very, very distinct very, very soon. So in the book they say, when you are trying to meditate, try to see which is more distinct, the left nostril or the right nostril, which is the breath is more distinct. You focus on that distinct side, and then while you are trying to do meditating, try to see the distinct point of contact, and then you just focus your mind on that point. Place your mind at that point of contact, and then you just try to be aware of the in-breath. So we say it is the touching point here, the in-breath. By the gentle touch, it goes in. By the gentle touch, it goes out. So you have to know by the touch, the in-breath and the out-breath. And never follow the breath either inward or outward. Always focus, you know, on that point only. Just keep your point one-pointedness. Only then you are, you know, your mind become one-pointedness and you will, you can develop the concentration. So as I do you, no? So whichever place you like, you just focus on there. It will become very distinct at that point. No? So it become very distinct, then you can, you know, you can meditate, you know, inward, outward, so, you know, by counting one, in, out, two. So if you, you know, can concentrate up to 1 hour without wandering, then we say you can stop counting. No? Without counting, you try to be aware of the in-breath, out-breath. No? See whether you can still concentrate, no, for 1 hour, no, without counting. Then you can go to the second step. Now the second step is the awareness of the length of the breath. So the length of the breath, no, is known by actually, no, the by if you are breathing, no, slowly, we say you can take the breath is long. And when the, and you are breathing fast, you can take, no, like that, the breath is very short. No? Sometimes you breathe. So you know it is long. No? So sometimes it may be short, sometimes it may be long. It should be natural. No? It should be natural. And what you have to take notice is, no, the length of the in-breath and the length of the out-breath should be equal. No, that is important. Just make it equal. And then, no, just try to be aware of the in-breath, out-breath as before again. No, so if you can, no, meditate up to 1 hour, no, without counting, you can go to the third, no, third step. Awareness of the whole breath. And we give you the example of the gatekeeper and the sawyer. Now in this step, you have to be aware of, no, the whole in-breath, starting from the beginning. No, starting from the beginning, the middle, and the end. No, all of them you have to be, you know, aware all the time. And then when you breathe out again, you have to be aware all the time. So this step is the most important, actually. No, if you focus very well, no, throughout from the beginning to the end, throughout from the beginning to the end, you will find that you can concentrate very well, no, very well. So we give, no, the example of the gatekeeper. No, in the rural city, no, the gatekeeper, no, he examined the people only when they come to the gate. And, no, those people who are approaching and those who are not leaving the gate, they do not concern with him. Only when it comes to the gate, no, he examined it. And the same thing we say, no, those incoming breath and outgoing breath, no, does not concern you. So only try to be aware of, no, the breath at the touching point. So when we say you are not trying to touch the whole in-breath and the whole out-breath, so at that time you are, no, you have to be mindful most of all the time. So breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. And then, no, while you are meditating that, and if you can, no, the awareness for the, if you can, no, the meditate up to 1 hour again without, no, without the mind wandering away. So we say you can go to the step four. But no, when we go to step four, it's actually you are doing this, no, this step three. No, that you just keep on doing that step three. No, and then while you are meditating, no, taking notice of that. So when you gain, no, the concentration becomes, no, the better and better. Then we say, no, the breath will become more and more subtle and gentle. Very, very, no, very, very remarkable. No, it is in other meditation subjects. No, when we advance to the higher state, the meditation subject becomes more and more distinct. But here, now it becomes in the higher state. So it becomes more and more subtle, subtle, gentle, gentle, finally it disappears. So you don't notice the breath anymore. So if you don't notice the breath anymore, you say you arrived, not the step four. That tranquilizing the breath till it disappears. Now at that point, you keep on meditating, until the breath becomes more and more gentle, and finally disappears. Now, when it disappears, you focus the mind at the touching point of the breath, touching point of the breath with the nostril or the upper lip, until the breath reappears. Then you continue meditation as step three, trying to be aware of the whole in-breath and whole out-breath again. And after this step four, usually, the meditation sign appears, we say. Now the meditation sign. So there are three types of meditation sign. One is we call preparatory sign, prikama namita. It is the breath, the in-breath and the out-breath. The natural in-breath and out-breath is taken as the preparatory sign. It prepares for the arising of the higher, the higher sign. And then, so we say, after this fourth step, when the breath reappears and you are meditating on the in-breath and out-breath again, and then you will see that the breath will become the gray like the cigarette smoke. And then after that, you will get usually a white mask. So it is like cotton or silk cotton appears at the touching point. At the touching point of the breath, with the nostril or the upper lip. So at that touching point, a white mask will appear. So only if the white mask appears at the touching point, we say it is normal. So if it appears in your forehead or away from your face, so it is not normal, don't pay attention to it. Just try to be aware of the in-breath and out-breath all the time. So now as you become mindful very well, so now the sign will come closer, and finally it appears at the touching point. Then we say, you attain the acquired sign. So when the acquired sign appears, you try to be aware of the in-breath and the out-breath. And then while you are trying to be aware of the in-breath and out-breath, you are also aware of the acquired sign. And then the in-breath and the out-breath and the acquired sign, they become homogeneous. If your mind becomes fixed on that acquired sign, keep it fixed, don't remove it again. Just you focus on that sign where the touching point arises. And then when you are meditating like that, and then you will see that the acquired sign slowly become brighter and brighter, and then it becomes very bright and very clear and bright. Like the evening star or the full moon, then we say you attain the counter sign. You attain the counter sign. So again, as soon as you attain the counter sign, you just try to be aware of the in-breath and out-breath as before, and then the counter sign appears at the touching point. So you will be also aware of the counter sign also. And then, just like before, if your mind remains focused on that counter sign, just keep it focused. And if you can focus for 1 hour, 2 hours or more, we say you attain the first jhana, So when the counter sign appears, we say you arrive at the neighborhood concentration at that time, neighborhood meditation. We call it, and then the concentration at that stage is also called as neighborhood concentration, upachara samadhi. So you attain the neighborhood concentration here, and then like in the park meditation center, the teacher to make you really attain the neighborhood concentration, so he asks you to look at your heart. Because if you correctly attain the neighborhood constraint, you can penetrably see your heart. You can see it. And in the blood of the heart, our life continuum, No, that keeps us alive. No, and then we also go at the mind door. So, no, on in the heart, depending on the heart base, no, that no, the life continuum arising. And no, actually, this counter sign appears that no, that mind door. No, at that mind door, there you can see the. No, when you can see the mind door, then no, you can no, also, no, the discern the jhana factors. No, jhana factors. No, in that no, in the breath, in the taking notice of the counter sign. So we have the five jhana factors. Remember. So above here, we show about five jhana factors. Huh? Above there. Maybe on that side. Okay, there are five jhana factors. Now, vitakka is initial obligation of the mind to the meditation object. And vichara, and vichara, sustained implication of the mind, not to the meditation object. Piti, joy, no, joy or fondness of the meditation subject. And then sukha is no, pleasant feeling or blissful enjoyment of that counter sign. And then upikha, neutral feeling and enjoyment of the counter sign. And then ekagada is unification and focusing the mind, no, on the counter sign. So they are the jhana factors, no, we call, no, they are mental factors that associate with the moral mind that we are meditating. So as we are meditating, no, continuously, so we are developing moral minds again and again, and then these jhana factors, they become stronger and stronger, you know, stronger and stronger. And they suppress, not that, the hindrances, no, not to arise. Vitakka, no. So if you are not applying the mind, no, with no, with great effort, so no, we say vitakka will eliminate, no, the sloth and torpor, no, sloth and torpor that make you lazy, and vichara, no, will suppress, no, the sceptical doubt, we call vijikecha, no, also they are, no, the. These, you know, the sloth and the vijikicca, they are defilement. No? They are defilement, not to arise. No, and piti, joy, suppress, no, the anger, no, very bad. No, the defilement, not to arise, and sukha, no, bliss, it suppress, no, the restlessness of the mind, and also remorse, we say, and restlessness also a, you know, a defilement. And then ekagata, no, suppresses sense desire, no, which is greed or craving, no, the worst, no, hindrance actually. So, no, as they suppress, no, these defilements not to arise. Now finally, no, they can, when they become strong enough, when you attain the neighborhood concentration, so, no, they are quite well developed and they can eliminate those hindrances totally, not to arise. So we say the mind becomes pure. No, you should understand when we say the mind is pure, what is that? So that is no arising defilement anymore. No, the mind becomes very, very pure. When it becomes pure, no, this hindrance no longer exists. The mind will be just very calm, very, no, the blissful and very peaceful actually when you attain that. And of course, no, when you attain the jhana, so they are fully developed, we say. No? And then when you become developed, no, fully, so piti, sukha, no, joy and the bliss are very, very high. So when we enjoy sensual pleasure with greed-rooted consciousness, no, with immoral mind, they also arise with them with greed-rooted consciousness. No? Greed-rooted consciousness. But no, when you enjoy the sensual pleasure, like watching the movie like that, so no, the piti, sukha, no, they are, no, they arise not only to a little extent actually, not very high, and that's why we say, no, when you attain the jhana, no, you are enjoying the greatest, no, mundane bliss, no, because they are very, very high, And when we attain the jhana, no, we have to practice five ways to gain mastery of the jhana. So, no, it is advised in the sutta that, no, when we attain the jhana, we should not enjoy it much. We should develop it much. No, we should develop it again and again, so that we can develop the jhana quickly, even in one snap, in one step. And it go, we also have to discern the five jhana factors, in the mind, and then, we also have to practice, to develop the concentration, and with the determination. Now, when I attain the jhana, may the jhana remains for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hours. So we have to practice like that. Then, by practicing like that, you can remain in the jhana state for 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. If you practice very well, you can remain even up to 7 days at a time. So if you are run out of money, don't worry, try to develop the jhana. No? You don't need to buy to eat, to drink. No? You live very peacefully and happily with the jhana. And then buddhanya, is being ability to emerge from the jhana attainment at any predetermined time. For example, it's now already 8:30. Now you develop the jhana. May I come out of the jhana at 10 p.m. So you develop the jhana. So when you are in the jhana, we also teach you in the Abhidhamma, the jhana attainment, remember? Now when you attain the jhana attainment, only jhana chitta arises. One after another, continuously, incessantly. They are taking the counter sign, just concentrating on the counter sign. So you are aware of only the counter sign and of about these jhana factors, and you are enjoying the jhana bliss, only that. And you don't know the sense object that appear in the five sense door. You don't know anymore. When it becomes 10 p.m., automatically, you come out of the jhana. So every time you can, you make the determination. And whatever determination you have made, you can come out at that time. We say you also attain the mastery of the coming out of the jhana. And pachvikhana vachi is ability to review the jhana factors very quickly with the jhana consciousnesses. Only when we attain the five jhana, we develop the second jhana. Now, when you go to the second jhana, you have to concentrate, focus on the counter sign again. But it is time without vitaka arising in the mind. So without vitaka, in practice, in meditation, only in teaching Abhidhamma, we say you eliminate vitaka first, then eliminate vichara. But in practice, we always eliminate vitaka, vichara simultaneously. You can do that. Many people can do that. So after eliminating vitaka, vichara, you get the second jhana with three jhana factors. Piti, sukha, ekagata. Then you eliminate, develop mastery in five ways, and then meditate on the counter sign again without piti also. So then when you can concentrate well for 1 hour, 2 hours or more, we say you attain the third jhana with only two jhana factors, sukha, ekagata. And here, sukha is the highest, so it is the highest mundane bliss that you can enjoy. Then, eliminating this sukha and upekkha ekagata will arise at the jhana factor, and you attain the fourth jhana. And the fourth jhana is very strong, very calm, very peaceful. The meditator, they say, when they attain the fifth jhana, it is very peaceful and blissful. So the Buddha said, in undertaking Vipassana meditation, if you can develop the fourth jhana and use this as the basis for meditation, it will be the best. The best Vipassana meditation. Okay, now after you can develop the right concentration with the anapanasati, you should also undertake some other meditation which supported in Vipassana meditation. And then usually after you can develop the food jhana, you should undertake the full guardian meditation. So it is wise to undertake full guardian meditation to protect oneself from internal enemies, defilements are internal enemies, and external enemies like wicked men and ghosts and beasts. And then guardian meditations are desirable at all places and at all times. So they are loving kindness meditation. So when you based on your food jhana concentration, you can radiate loving kindness very attentively and very effectively, and you can even develop while you are developing loving kindness, radiating loving kindness, you can develop up to the tat jhana in the food jhana method, because you can go up to the tat jhana. Then you can also meditate radiate loving kindness to all living beings by 528 modes of metta or loving kindness. So very peaceful and sublime state of living. And then number two is the recollection of the Buddha's attributes. So there are nine attributes. You meditate all the nine attributes first, and then you choose one that you like best. And then if you concentrate in Araham, now if you can concentrate it for 1 hour, 2 hours without the mind wander away, so we say you attain the neighborhood concentration. You cannot get the jhana here. You get the neighborhood concentration, but even then, your faith and confidence in the Buddha will arise very well. And your body is filled up with the noble attribute of the Buddha, so it is well protected from all dangers. And you also have the feeling that you are living together with the Buddha. So that means you undertake meditation better by meditating that. And number three is recollection of foulness on a dead corpse. So to do that, actually, you don't need to go to the cemetery. If you have seen a corpse before, now you develop your food jhana. You come out of the jhana and you try to see that corpse that you have seen. It will appear in front of you. So the mind becomes very powerful, become like that. So the disgusting nature of the corpse, you focus on that and you meditate on that. Disgusting. You can develop up to the first jhana. As you have already attained the fourth jhana, it's not very difficult, so quite easy to develop. And the Buddha advises all the monks to undertake this meditation because it is very beneficial. So you will have the perception of foulness when you get the first jhana. And it can suppress the worst defilement that we call greed, and we also call it raga, lust raga. Lust raga is, we say, it is the raga oga. It is the one that commit the sexual misconduct, raping the ladies and even killing the ladies. So when you attain this, that perception of calmness can subdue this lust, raga, or the tanha very well. Very, very well. And you even can behave like an arhat. Like an arhat, they say. So not much attention, not much interest in the sensual pleasure anymore. You don't crave for any sensual anymore. And then you can meditate very, very quickly to advance in Vipassana meditation. And also the Buddha advises to undertake recollection of death. So focusing that not that person you have seen before, and then you reflect on yourself. My being alive is uncertain, my death is certain. You reflect on that. And then you can also develop only to the neighborhood concentration. But it's also very, very, you know, beneficial. So, you know, you will develop, you know, strong urgency to meditate. Oh, I can die at any moment. You become very aware of that. Then you will not postpone, don't meditate anymore. Then, no, if you can meditate, no, study correctly and the, you know, the, with great effort, some people they can finish, not the whole meditation. No. I think several people can finish in 3 months. Just imagine, no, if by just meditating 3 months, no, you are you get the jhana and you get, no, all the vipassana, no, inside knowledges. And then you become extreme winner. Then it is the best attainment in life. No, it is worth many billions of dollars actually. No, we should, no, we should exert the effort, no, to come and meditate at least, no, 3 months. No. Okay. And then we say, no, another meditation very much advised by the Buddha. And it is also, you know, like taught in light in the Power Meditation Center, mindfulness occupied with the body. We call kayakata sthiti. And this is, you know, the recollection of powerness is, you know, recollection of the powerness in the dead body. Now this is reflection powerness in the living body. So, you know, this living body, although we love ourselves very much, and we are much attached to our beloved one, no, thinking, no, very beautiful and very lovely, no. So if you attain, no, like we say, the jhana concentration, you can see all the 32 parts of the body very easily. No, the head hair, the body hair, the nails, the teeth, the skin, the flesh, and then, no, the sinews, and then, no, the blood, the heart, the livers, all the 32 parts, including excrement, urine, pus, blood, so the disgusting thing. And each part, you should reflect on the disgusting nature of that part. And you will see, no part is beautiful. All the 32 parts are very disgusting. And then, like in Power Meditation Center, that the Paucharo asks you to focus on your skeleton. If you can see yourself as 32 parts of the body, you can all see other people as 32 parts of the body. Then the notion of person, and man, woman disappear. You see the only 32 parts. All the 32 parts are moving around. And who have reflected on the skeleton. So while you are thinking about, you can see only the bones, the skeleton, the thinking the part, walking, only skeleton, the walking. So very, very effective, actually, this meditation. So if you meditate, on the skeleton, the disgusting nature, you can also develop first jhana. And again, you can also attain the perception of foulness. Now that can suppress greed, raga, or lobha very, very well. So after that, you can do meditation already. And we also describe you the kasina meditation. So in the kasina meditation, you can develop four rupavajra jhana, and then you can also develop four arupavajra jhana. So to develop 8 jhanas, in each kasina, and after you can develop these 8 jhanas in all the 10 kasina, then you can develop supernormal power, supernormal knowledges. There are 7 of the next page actually. You can raise. Go up. So we said, going higher to supernormal knowledges. So it is actually, we say, the highest stage of Samatha meditation, to develop the supernormal knowledges. So you can develop, so we say, like Adivida Abhinya, various supernormal powers, and by this power, you can even fly in the air, and then can dive into the earth and walk on water, And you can make a little, much. So, ice cream for 1 month, one cup, you can make 100 cups for all the people here. So, actually, it's very, very wonderful. And Pup Bini Vasa Nusri Abhinya, you can recollect your past existence. Just in the case of the Buddha, he could see the past existence of every person. As soon as he looked at you, by looking at your mind, all your past existence are recorded in the mind. All these are recorded. So he could know in all your past existence, and what have you done in the existence, and what meditation you have done. How is the level of your meditation? So the Buddha can give you the right the meditation, the right teaching, so that you can become the noble person very easily. And then we say the cito priya abhinya, para citta vijanana abhinya, reading the minds of other people. And then the Vipassana abhinya is the divine ear. You don't need to use the elephant anymore, because you can hear. Everyone's talking, even what the Russian President Putin is talking. What is the American President, the tongue is talking. You can you can even hear like that. You can even hear the voices of the celestial being, they say. And then Vipassana abhinya, divine eye, see and near and far away. And then in the case of the divine eye of the Buddha, very, very powerful. As the Buddha, he had performed the normal, the noble perfection, the fulfilling noble perfection. For full asankhya, asankhya means uncountable world system. So his divine eye is very powerful. He could see 100,000 crores of world system. The worlds, 100,000 crores. All living beings, on this, 1,000 crores. And then you can all see all these living beings in terms of ultimate mentality, materiality, arising, perishing very rapidly. So when he undertook the Vipassana meditation, we call it Mahavajira, Vipassana, the greatest Vipassana. So focusing on all these living beings, on their mental and materiality, and he meditate, the anicca, impermanent, abundance, dukkha, suffering, and anatta, not self. So his meditation is most powerful, actually. When he can develop the, for him, he can develop the full part wisdom very, very easily, actually. It takes him only about 3 hours to do that Mahavajira, Vipassana meditation. And then after you attain the divine eye, you also attain this two more supra normal knowledges. Yatha kamubhaga abhinya, power of same beings in 31 planes of existence, and knowing their respective karmas, which give rise to their present existence. And the Buddha can know the law of karma from this the supernormal knowledge. And anagatamta abhinya, power of knowing future existence of oneself and of others, and also future events and future worlds. So the people, as they cannot see their past existence and future existence, they always have doubt whether I've been born in the past or in the future. But in the case of Buddha, as he has this supernormal power, now he can see the past existence of every person, the future existence of every person. And he said, every one of us have lived uncountable existence already. And you should believe that. You should believe that. And actually, I have written the book for the karma, the real creator. And there I explain how the karma produce all living beings in the world. And I also give the concrete evidences, the each day, every day, you know, even today's, you know, the evidences, not that we have past existence and future existences. And it is very interesting, actually. And then Mr. Lai is printing that book. Almost finished, I think.
Almost,
not yet. So, not very soon available. Not very soon available. Okay, so we finish with Samatha meditation. We go to the Vipassana meditation. So, now we have not finished. Only two steps of purification of the mind. One is purification of morality, which suppress the gross defilement not to arise in the mind. Not the morality was suppressed, the gross defilement. And then number two is developing the right concentration, and by that we can also develop purity of the mind. So we already get two things. Then when you come to number three, purity of view, deity visuti, how to get rid of all the wrong views. So there is a third step. Now the meditator should undertake rupa kamatana. When he comes into, when you enter into vipassana, you begin with this. You have to begin with this. And then you have to take rupa kamatana. Now that is chatu dhatu vavatthana meditation. So breaking down our body into tiny particles called rupa kalapa. In Pali we call material groups. Rupa kalapa. And to see them arising and perishing incessantly and analysis the material groups, not to know the ultimate materiality. To know ultimate materialities. For example, we have four primary elements. Patvi, we also call it the element of solidity. Or somebody call it the earth element. And then it has the characteristic of the hardness and softness. Abho is the element of liquidity, and then it has the characteristic of cohesiveness and fluidity, just like the water is predominant in Abho. Tejo is heat. It has a characteristic of hotness and coldness. And Vayo is we call it the element of motion. It has the characteristic of pushing and supporting. And this eight characteristics. In the meditation, when we say of the four primary elements, you have to meditate on these eight characteristics. You can start with hardness. So now if you put the teeth together, it becomes very hard. You can feel that very hard. So in that one place where the hardness is the distinct, then you just meditate hardness. So when it becomes very distinct, you can spread it so that you can be aware of the hardness in every part of the body, the whole body. The body becomes very hard, like that, like a stone. And then when you reflect on the nature of softness, so not softness, usually we touch the inner depths with our tongue. So we can feel the softness. So from one place, softness, and you can make it distinct in the whole body, and throughout the whole body becomes very soft. You cannot sit erect, you just bend down like that. And then when we start like hotness. Actually, while you're putting your hand here, you can feel the hotness here. You can just pinch like this. And then from that one place, hotness, if you just meditate on that. When it becomes very hot, you can spread it, to spread all over the body. Then you will feel very, very hot. Even when the season is very cold, you don't need the drug. You don't need the even the coat like that. because you can even become perspiring, very hot. And that's why some sadhu, English, the Indian sadhu, they live in the Himalayas, Himalayas forest in the mountain, with only a little cloth, with no clothes at all. Though it is very cold, other people will have to put overcoat, but for them, they can live without coat. So again, if you don't have any drug, when you are in a place when you are sleeping, so you can just meditate the hotness of that. And when it is very hot, you can also meditate on coolness again. Any place when you are having the breeze touching your cheek, it can go here. So you just meditate on that coolness, and when become very distinct, then you spread it slowly to spread all over the body. Now every part of the body become very cold. Then, so though the people were very hot, for you it is very cold. So that the mind is very, very powerful, very powerful. So when you can know all the eight, the characteristics, distinct, so try to meditate on one after another, to know them each one, one after another, and then at the same time to know all of them, eight of them. Then you focus your attention on this eight, eight characteristics. And if you just focus on that, you can just sit 1 hour after 1 hour, like that. And then your concentration arises very quickly, actually. And then you will find that very brightly start coming out from the body. From little it becomes brighter. Oh, very bright light coming out. Then, so with close eye you can see everybody, as we say, because you attain the neighborhood concentration. So if you, based on the fifth jhana, you can attain the neighborhood concentration very easily, not very long, you're meditating. Even in 1 day or 2 days, you can get it. And then after you attain this on the neighborhood concentration, keep on focusing on that, the eight characteristics of the four primary elements. Just try to keep it there. And then slowly you will see that it becomes the gray and then white and then very clear. You can see like a block of ice. The whole body becomes like a block of ice or a block of glass. Because at that time you are seeing the translucent materiality. Pasada rupa. We have eye translucent materiality, nose translucent materiality, remember? We got the eye door, the ear door, the nose door. So they are very important, this translucent materiality. They are produced by karma. So when you can see that, then if you try to discern that four primary elements by discerning their eight characteristics, penetratively into this block, the block breaks down. Then your body breaks down, that's you, and you can see material group arising and perishing. So amazing, you think the body is very permanent. It is contact, it is compact, you think that. But now, when you can develop concentration and see penetratively, you can see it as material group. So ultimate materialities are very, very, the subtle, they arise only as material groups. So at least the material group will contain these four primary elements. And then when four primary elements group together, also four derived elements we call the visible object. And then the smell, the smell, the taste, and then the nutriment also arise. So these eight material, they always arise at material group. And then in the karma bond materiality, they also contain jivita rupa. Jivita rupa is the material light, we say, that that keep the karma bond materiality to last throughout their lifespan. we call them, no? And that is also our life, actually. No? And then when you can see, no, the chakupasada, the idol. So chakupasada combined with that as the ten ingredients. So ten material, rice and material group. So you can discern all material groups, no, in the whole body, and you have to analyze them, no, into, no, to know, no, the individual materiality. No, you have to discern the full primary materiality first, no, as you have discerned in the body. So after knowing them, then you can also discern, no, the other materiality. So like in Visuddhi Magga, and in my book in Visuddhi Magga also, we describe, no, the characteristic of each materiality and the function, no, the function it performs, and also the result of this function. We call pachupatthana, or in English we call manifestation, we say. And then, no, the food is the nearest cause that give rise to this materiality. So, no, the Buddha, no, the rights that we have to define each ultimate materiality by these four characteristics. No, its characteristic, its function, its manifestation, and proximity cause. Only if you define like that, no, they have no shape, no form, no, this the ultimate materiality. They are in the material group, and, no, you need your, no, the very powerful concentration to discern, no, in this group, to know, no, this each materiality, to define them by their characteristics. So this is very important. No, only then you know, no, the body is made up of 28 types of, no, the ultimate materiality. No, otherwise, you don't know. If you don't know, you don't understand about the body. No, you have to know about this, no, the components of the body. They are the really exist in our body. And this material, no, ultimate materiality, they combine together in material groups. And this material group actually combine together to form, no, the cells. And the cells combine together to form the organs. And the organ combine together to form this body. So this body is actually the combination of this material group. But really exists in this material group. No, but we think, oh, this body, no, is real, really exists. But now, as we say, no, when you can look penetratively, this body disappears. No longer exists. Okay? So if you can see it by yourself, you say, seeing is believing. No, then you will believe it. No, you will believe it. But now with our mind, when we are seeing, oh, man, human, no, you, I exist. So it is seeing is deceiving, we say. No, not believing, because we are defied and blinded by the ignorance and other defilement. No, so what we are seeing is not just superficial. And that is the concept which is built up by the mind, that we think, oh, person really exists, I really exist. So if you think I exist, you know, you will be always attached to this I and to this body. If you are always attached to this body, you will always be born again and again. You will never become enlightened. No? So when you see the ultimate reality, then, no, you can cut off your attachment and all other defilement. You can cut off. Then you can see, no, you become liberation, no, from all the realms of suffering, and then enjoy the, no, eternal peace forever. Okay. Then we go to the next one. The next one is the, you know, we say, no, we have to take the nama kamatana. So the next one, nama is mentality, kamatana is meditation object. No, we have to take mentality and meditation object, and we have to observe, no, the cognitive series of consciousness that arise in the six sense door. So in Abhidhamma, no, I already taught you, so can you show chart number 9 for some time? So, no, so to see this, no, this body, you need, no, to the concentration, as the Buddha said. No, without the concentration, you cannot see this thing. So what you have to do now is, now if you have seen, you know, the, we say translucent material in the eye, and that represents the eye door. Now you have to see eye translucent material, and then, you know, the mind door. Now that is our life continuum consciousness that arises in the heart. So you are right, and you see together, and see a visible object coming in contact, you know, with the eye door and the mind door. They appear, you know, that object appears in these two doors simultaneously. And then we get this cognitive series, you know, arising in the mind door, we see. You know? So I already taught you. So if I keep on explaining again, it will be not very, it will take much time. So now when you see this cognitive series, you have to discern each consciousness, you know, by its characteristic, and by its function, and by its manifestation and proximate cause. After seeing each consciousness, again you have to penetratingly, you know, discern the mental factors that associate with each consciousness. We have already said that, you know, just like in eye consciousness, chakku vijnana, so only, you know, seven mental factors, you know, the associate. When you come to like, you know, the vatthapana, there's manodhara vachana, 12, you know, neutral mental factors associate with it. The jhavanas can be moral minds or immoral minds, like in lopa mula cheta, greed rooted consciousness, 19 to 21 mental factor associate. If moral mind, mahakusala cheta arises, then the 31 to 34 mental factors can associate with them. So you have to discern all these mental factor, mental factor. So we say again, by penetratively, look at each consciousness and try to see whether passa is present. Passa is the contact that makes the contact between consciousness and sense object. So if that contact is present, you know contact is present. And then because of this contact, feeling arises. Feeling is the sensation, and it is the feeling that, not that enjoys the taste of the feeling. So if you can discern like that, you know feeling is present. So in that way, you can discern all the mental factors again. Remember, altogether there are in the brief method we have 89 types of consciousness, and then 52 types of mental factors. So, but not all consciousness arises in us. Like in the when we are three rooted person, only 45 chaita will be arising, and when you get the jhana, also the jhana chaita will be arising. So you have to see all these jhana consciousnesses and the mental factors, that arise in them, in each of them. So now defining this ultimate mentality and ultimate materiality by their respective, the characteristic, function, manifestation and proximate cause is very, very important. Only then, we say, you have. Okay, we can go to the chat again. We can develop, by this, we can develop. So the next page, I think, we can say that this okay here. So nama rupa prichida jnana, the knowledge of the characterization or the knowledge of defining mentality, materiality. This knowledge is very important. And it is, this knowledge is the landmark of the purity of you. So, what purity of you have? You may ask. So now when you observe this ultimate mentality, materiality, they are rising very rapidly. So like consciousness, the Buddha said, can arise and perish, conscious mental factors, at the rate of 1,000 billion. Even in one snap of the hand. And then we say materiality can also arise and perish at the rate of 58 billion per second, more than 58 billion per second. Very quickly they are rising and perishing. So only you see that, they are impermanent. They are impermanent. As soon as they arrive, they perish. As soon as they perish. Not just not like looking at the light, and some pain in your body inside, not trying to meditate, pain, and then slowly it disappears. There is not a nature. No? So you have to see, no? Very quickly they are arising. These are the reality. No? Real, that really exists. And they arise very quickly. No? And then you know that, oh, no, these mentalities are impermanent. And then, what is not permanent? No? It's not satisfactory. And to be tortured by the dissolution, perishing of this materialities and mentality that make up our body and mind, and we love our body and our mind and ourselves very much, and seeing us, oh, perishing, dying all the time. So that really amounts to, if you see like that, it really amounts to suffering. Seeing yourself dying, it would be real suffering, no? So only just by having pain, having suffering, just meditation on that is not vipassana. Not vipassana. No, you have to meditate on this, no, the characteristic. So, no, a nature, impermanent characteristic. And now we say, no, suffering, no, suffering characteristic is a dukkha. And not self. And that is very important, is not self. No, not self mean, no, self do not exist, actually. No? So we think, no, we exist, I exist, you know? So, no, we exist and we are born. No, we are permanent, we are thinking. And having this body is quite pleasant, because, you know, eating ice cream is very enjoyable. So you think this body is pleasant, no? So, no, actually, no, in reality, no, as materiality arising, perishing, no, quickly they say, no, they are impermanent, they are suffering, and they are not self, and they are not beautiful. No, you think, no, we are very pure, every person is beautiful. So that the Buddha said, you meditate on that, no, the kaya kadasti, that the two parts of the body, and then, no, just, no, try to discern it. Every part is disgusting. No, if you see that, nobody is beautiful. And also in the West, they also have, no, the statement, beautiful, no, is skin deep, they say. Beautiful is skin deep. Only we are seeing, no, when a person, we are seeing his skin. And when you say he's very beautiful, by looking at the skin, actually. No? Now, no, with your wisdom, no, you can look at the, no, the Miss Universe, who is the most beautiful lady in the world. So try to peel out her outer skin. The outer skin is very, very thin, actually. So you just peel it up. It will amount to just a handful. No, smear with blood. Smell very fishy. Try to get the gentleman. This is the beauty of Miss Universe. Who like to get it? Nobody will take it. Nobody will take it. That is her beauty, actually. So if you peel out the outer skin, how would her body look like? No longer beautiful. No, just like a dead skin. No, a dead skin, no, the goat or a dead skin pig, no, in the butcher shop. So no gentleman would like to embrace her anymore. So, no, if you can look like that, no, so, no, then nobody is actually beautiful, actually, no? So if if you see like that, no, would that be good or not? So, no, for us, we don't like, because we like to see beautiful things. We crave for beautiful things, so, no? So it develops, no, beautiful things, it develops greed, anger, no, hatred. So because of this, no, you have to try to enjoy sense pleasure, and then, you know, the sense pleasure do not give you real happiness, no, because it associates with, you know, the greed, ignorance, anger, greed, and then pride. These are very hot fire. The Buddha said, the hottest fire, Buddha said. No, and then sense pleasure. No, when we enjoy sense pleasure, only we are enjoying that, you know, the sukha, the pleasant feeling. Lensing pain, as soon as I arise, it perish. As soon as I arise, it perish. So we say sense pleasure is transient. And then it is fleeting. As soon as I arise, it perish. So now after you are done, you're enjoying your thing, you're enjoying very well your thing, after the movie is over, only your mind becomes blank. Nothing is happening. No sensation anymore. No? So, and then the greed. No, it is greed that lies it. And what greed, no, becomes satisfied and gratified. So we think, no, we are happy. We are happy. And we don't know that greed always creeps for. No? If it gets one thing, it will creep for 10 things. If you get 10 things, it will creep for 100 things. So that just trying to satisfy the craving of greed. No, you will be busy the whole life. So you will never get real happiness. So you will get real happiness only when you can eliminate all these causes of suffering we call defilement. No? Okay. So now, no? And then here also, no, you get that not self. No, not self. I like to tell you a little bit. No? So actually I even give away some books on the not self. No, which it are the my research paper, that I put up in a Buddhist conference, about the not self. No, so the Buddha said not self characteristic is not distinct, because it is covered by the compactness of mentality and materiality. So materiality, they arise in that compactly, so as a body. So we cannot see not self. We think this is self. We think that ego, like that. Person, we think like that. No? So, and again, mentality, they also arise as group, not individually. No? So when only you can discern each mentality, each materiality, then we say you can divide, you can break down the compactness of mentality and materiality. No, they become individual. When they become individual, as soon as they arise, they perish. As soon as they arise, they perish. So nothing remains. So what remains? To be called self. To be called I. What remains? Nothing. No, nothing. No, like in the monotheistic religion, they say, oh, God created us, and they put the soul, not the ego. No, like the Brahmanism say, oh, they put the, the atta. The atta, no, they put it here. So this self, the atta or soul will never perish. No, will always remain, very permanent, they say. And then the Buddha, he could see penetratively all living beings in 1,000 crow system, world system. He could not see no soul, no ego, no self, no I. So he said, now it is a not-self characteristic. So to see this not-self characteristic is most important in meditation, actually. Now, only if you can see this and you can reflect not-self, anatta, anatta, anatta. So that is real vipassana, actually. Now, only then you can get rid of this selfishness. Now, because thinking that self, I exist, everybody becomes very selfish. And because of this selfishness, you want to get as much as possible for yourself, not for the welfare of others, not for the welfare of others anymore. And because of this selfishness, the people, they quarrel with each other, and we get the wars, the wars, and then even the British Prime Minister, by the name of William Gladstone. No, he said, the selfishness is the worst curse of humanity. No, that the curse means curse. Curse. So it's the best, the best thing to get, because of this selfishness. So if we can get rid of this not self, and selfishness will disappear, then we will be very happy, very happy. Okay, so we go to we get the purity of you now. So now when the Buddha now can see like that, he can get rid of the wrong view, not that we take to be not to be self exist, and not the worst wrong view is we call it personality belief, sakkaya ditthi they call it. Personality belief, believing person exist, I exist, this body mind is I. So taking that is a personal belief, we say it. And then there's also the disease, self illusion, ego illusion, thinking that soul, self, jiva atta exists, thinking like that become also very selfish. And if you are selfish, the Buddha said, you will not escape the woeful rebirth when you die. So the Buddha even said, even your head is on fire, the Buddha said. And if you are, your clothing are on fire, so it is more urgent to quench these fires, to quench them is very urgent. But more urgent to that is to get rid of your selfishness, the personal belief, the other illusion, the self illusion. So to get rid of them is more important, the Buddha said, because only then you will not be born in the woeful state again. Okay, we go to the number four. Purity. So we start with samdhati. Coming very close, So purity, transcending doubt, So we have, the Buddha described here, there are 16 kinds of doubt. So we just say quickly now. So we have, the five doubts concerning the past existence. So have I been born in the past existence? Or have I not been born in the past? Or what have I been born in the past, past existence? As a man, as a woman, or as a dog? How have I been born in the past? Am I beautiful or ugly, something like that? And from what state into what state? From what existence to what existence did I change in the past? And there are also five doubts in the future. Shall I be born again in the future? Or shall I not be born in the future? What shall I be born in the future? How shall I be born in the future? From past day into past day, shall I change in the future? And then we have six doubts concerning the present. Am I existing now? Or am I not existing? What am I? How am I? Whence has this being come? From what existence? I come to this existence. And whether will it go? From this existence, what existence shall I go? So there are 16 kinds of doubts, and they are very similar to the we call vijikicca, the skeptical doubt. So just below that again we have vijikicca. Now vijikicca, the skeptical doubt is also similar to that we say that 16 doubts. So vijikicca, vijikicca is we call skeptical doubt, remember? It is also a defilement. So it has doubt, about the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. That the Buddha possessed omniscient wisdom, he knows everything. So as he don't know about the attribute of the Buddha, he has doubt about it. But for us, we don't have any doubt. Because the Buddha knows all these ultimate realities, and then about the mind in detail, and about how to purify the mind totally to attain the highest attainment in life. So this shows the Buddha really attains omniscient wisdom. Nobody knows about this thing, actually. And all the Dhammas are the ultimate truth and ultimate realities that nobody knows. The Buddha teaching them so that we can escape from woeful rebirth and can also attain Nibbana. So if we know about that, we can get rid of the vijikicca. And vijikicca also has doubt about the past existences, the future existences. And also about the, you know, the law of karma, the law of dependent origination, and the Four Noble Truths. So, you know, they have the doubt because they don't know. No, if you don't know, then you have the doubt. So then in order to get rid of, you know, these, you know, the 16 doubts and the vijikicca, so the Buddha said, you know, you have to, you know, to take meditation to see the causal relations of dependent origination. Now this dependent origination is very great, you know, the discourse of the Buddha. So it explains, you know, why every person is being born again and again. And then, no, also in Abhidhamma, we shall teach you in chat number 8 actually. But here, you can go to the next page. So, no, the Buddha described briefly about the 11 causal relations of, no, the, so the next page at the bottom, I think, no, we have. No, already we pass already. Page 12, I think it is. Here, page 12. No, page 12 is not then cause effect relation. And then we have to go page 13, 14. No, the question, I like to have the, we already passed here. Okay, here. This one, page 13. You have to begin with 12. Page 12. No, page 12. So, no, I like to tell you briefly again about this. So, no, at the bottom, maybe. At the bottom. Page 12. At the bottom. So, okay, number one here. Now, there are 11 causal relations dependent on ignorance, avijja, arise, karma formation, no, sankhara. Dependent on karma formation, arise, resultant consciousness, vijnana. Dependent on the resultant consciousness, arise, associated mental factors, no, we go on the nama and karma born materiality, rupa. And depending on materiality, mentality, materiality arise internal basis called, no, the, no, like the eye base, the ear base, no, the sixth sense door, no, arises. And depending on the sixth sense door arise contact, no, with the sense object. And because of this contact, no, the feeling arises, vedana. And depending on feeling arises craving. No, when we have feeling, no, whether it's good or bad, craving, tanha, always arise. And depending on craving, no, grasping, no, grasping or clinging, no, arises. And then depending on grasping or clinging, no, karma formation, you perform new actions again, no, to attain what you grasp or cling for. No, we call it karma bhava. And then depending on karma formation, in the present existence arises, no, rebirth, no, in the future existences. And depending on future, no, according to the birth, no, so depending on birth arise decay and death. No, decay and death is aging and death, you might say, jaramarana, worry, worry, and then soka, lamentation, prideva, pain, dukkha, grief, domanasa, and despair, upayasa. So when they arise, in moral mind arise, and again ignorance arise again. So it goes on like that. So now in this 11 causal relation. So number one is we call avijja. No, avijja is ignorance, it is a defilement, no, ignorance. And number seven. No, number seven, craving is tanha, and grabbing is, no, the clinging or grasping. No, it is also tanha and greed. No, the wrong view. So, no, these three, that, you know, the avijja, tanha, upadana. No, so we say ignorance, and then the, you know, the craving and grasping. We call them, you know, the realm of defilement. Because of this realm of defilement, no, all living beings be, you know, performing both, you know, the good action and bad actions. No, you are performing. No, for example, oh, no, the chicken curry is very tasty. No, you say that. So thinking chicken curry really is ignorant. No, ignorance give us, you know, the wrong view that, oh, chicken curry really exists. What really exists is materiality, mentality. No, no, no chicken actually. So when you know chicken curry, you know, it's good. So tanha, greed, no, greed for it. And then clinging, no, or grasping, no, becomes, no, strongly greed for it to get it. Then you kill the chicken and you cook it. So you perform evil actions. And then, no, we say, oh, slash your happiness is very great. So, no, thinking slash your beings exist, or again, ignorant. So when we think, oh, slash your happiness is very great, we crave for it. So the craving, tanha, arises. And when tanha becomes, you know, very strong as grasping, oh, I want to be born as the slash your being, you perform meritorious deeds. So when you perform meritorious deeds, no, the Buddha says, sankhara and kamma arises. No, the action you are doing, no, the chitana, volition, the one that, no, perform the action. So the consciousness and the volition performing the action are called sankhara. And then the kamma bhava arises. No, kamma bhava is kamma property. No, the property of the action arises in the mind. No, we say, no, and then, no, this kamma. So if perform, no, immoral action, billions of immoral mind arise, like in killing a chicken, then billions of immoral karma arises in us. And then this, when this karma, no, bear result, we are born in the woeful state again and again. And then when you perform meritorious deed, we say, no, moral mind and the immoral karma arise by many billions. And when they produce result, so you are born in blissful realm again and again. Again and again. And then for the karma, no, to produce, no, the next existence, it also requires the support of, no, that ignorance, craving, and upadana, the clinging again. No, because, no, like we say, no, from a mango seed, no, mango tree arises. But if you put the mango seed, no, in a closed bottle, it will never arise. It will never give rise to a tree. Only when you put on the earth, put water, and then you get, no, sunlight and air, only that it arises. No, the tree arises. The same thing, no, karma. It can bear the future existence. No, only when you get the support of, no, ignorance, craving, and then, no, we say, oh, to be celestial being is very good. So it is also, you know, the ignorance, craving, and grasping. And because you want to get that, you perform meditation, and you get this existence. You are born in this existence. No? So, no, if you combine this, no, three, no, the, we say, that the, no, the realm of karma, three of them, avijja, no, ignorance, craving, and then the grasping. And then you combine, because of that we perform. No, so we say, no, the karma formations and the karma property arises. So the five of them, no, actually they act together. And because of these five causes, we are born in the new existence. When you are born in a new existence, but really born are, no, so again, chart number 9, the bottom one. But really born are resultant consciousnesses. No, we call vinyana, result consciousnesses. And then, no, associated mental factors. So, no, when the karma produce a new existence, this consciousness, resultant consciousness arises. And then associated mental factors also arises. And then the karma born material also arises. So that as our body, so we say five aggregates arises. When we get consciousness aggregate, when we get mentality, we have feeling aggregate, perception aggregate, and the aggregate of mental formation, we say. So, and then here, material aggregate. That five aggregate means a new existence. So when you get the mentality, materiality, so we say the sixth sense door arises again. So we call that sanlayarana. And then the sixth sense object come in contact. You get pasa, contact. Because of contact, feeling arises. So if the feeling arises, craving will go on again. So these are the five effects. So to get rid of all those the 16 doubts, the 16 doubts, and also the vijikicca, septical doubt. We have to discern the causal relation of dependent origination. So you have to see the present existence as the five effects. The five effects are this one. We say consciousness, associated mental factors, that is nama, and karma born materially, rupa, nama rupa, and then the sixth sense door, sanlayarana, and then the pasa virana. The pasa is contact and feeling. So these are the five, the five effects in this present. So you have to see, you are rebirth consciousness. So in Abhidhamma, the Buddha also said that when we can discern mentality, materiality, arising and perishing, and defining them, defining them by four characteristics, in us and in others, you can trace, the Buddha said, the mental stream of arising and perishing, backward and forward. So you can, from now, you try to see your mental materiality, and then you can trace the mental material backwards until you are conceived in the mother's womb. So you are consciousness, rebirth consciousness. And then you can see the five effects. And then if you tracing backward again, the mental stream, you get to the immediate past life. So when you get to intermediate past life, you can also see the action done in this past life, and then you have to see about the near death time. Now when we say at the time of near death sign arises. Near death sign arises. So from that near death sign, near death sign you can note the karma formation and the karma. And then from the associated the consciousness and mental factor, you can also discern those three, the ignorance, the craving, and then grasping. So you can get these five effect, five causes in the past existence, and with the five effects in the present, you can correlate. So if they the true causal relation, because of these five causes, this five effect arising, you can see it. You can see it. And then also, you make like in the Pau Center, you perform meritorious deed now. Say offering food to the Buddha. So at that time, try to know about your moral mind arising and the karma that deposited, and then what you wish to be. If you want to be a celestial being, again we say it is ignorance, thinking the celestial being exists, and trying to, wishing to get it, to exist in the craving, and then grasping to get it very, very strongly, so you perform meritorious deed. So you develop five causes here now. Remember, the ignorance, and then craving, and then the grasping, and then moral action, and moral karma arises here. And because of this, what would be the future existence? You try to see. you will see. Now that you see, like standing, you are not your causal relation. You will see. Usually, what you wish for really appear. So, if the celestial being appear, try to see his rebirth consciousness, and then essential associated mental factors, karma bond materiality, and then six sense door and pasa vidana, try correlate. Because of these five causes, this five effect really arise or not? Oh, it arises, it's correct. So in that case, the Buddha, the light in power center, we are asked to see at least our three past existences and correlate the third existence with the second existence. Second existence with the first existence, you correlate. And then you correlate also in the future. As soon, as far as you can see your future existence, you have to see. You have to see. And usually in power management center, when you come to this state, they cannot see many future existence anymore. Only one or two future existence. That means they will attain the liberation from the human, from the realm of rebirth actually. So when we can attain that, then we can get rid of all those 16 doubts, remember? And when we can also get rid of the vijikicca, having doubt about the dependent origination, depend about the karma, about past existence, future existence, all can be eliminated. And then we go to the chat again. So we go to the number 14, page 14. Page 14, please. So don't go yet. Don't please go here, I think. No? After discerning clearly all causal relation from the third past existence to the future, to the last future existence, he can observe the whole series of the arising and perishing of mentality, materiality, extending from the most past existence to the last future existence. So he can get rid of all 16 doubts described earlier. And the causal relation as described by the law of dependent origination. So we can leave that. And then we can also see the four causes. And then after you get rid of the doubt, you also should see the four causes which give rise to the materiality, arising of. So chakku dwara here. So actually, we have to know above, I think. Above. So we have to find the causal relation, the causes that give rise to materiality. So not yet, maybe on 14. On 14. Okay. So we come to the next page again. It should be. So the four causes. So okay, I just tell you. So the four causes that give rise to materiality, we say it is karma, chaita consciousness, and then heat, and then the nutriment. So to know that our consciousness is giving rise to the materiality. So you try to see your mind door, and then your forefinger. Then when you try to bending the finger slowly, you can see that mind-born materiality arises by many billions, from in your eye door, you can see. Arising the billions, and that is bending the hand. Now materiality here arise and perish, and then it will bend a little, arise and perish, bend a little, arise and perish. In that way, the finger it bends down, and you know that all our actions and movements are due to all these mind-born materialities. Otherwise, we cannot move. And then In each material group, no, I told you there are eight materiality, patvi, abodhi, jo, vayo, vanna, ganda, radha, oja. So, no, in every material group, the jo, heat element present. And if you look at the heat on the heat element, it will give rise to, no, heat bond materiality, one after another, no, continuously, you can see that. And also from the, no, the nutriment oja. No, when this oja, we call it internal oja, and the nutriment from the food we eat it, no, come contact. They also produce, no, the nutriment bond materiality one after another. And then, no, when you can see the karma that produce this existence, as we have seen before, you can also see the karma bond materiality, no, again and again. So you know all the causes, no, that give rise to the. So when you know all these causes and like this thing, no, so you go to the mental factors, consciousness mental, no, mental factor, they arise by the contact of the eye door and the visible object, the ear door and the sound. Now we already saw that. So now we know all the causes that give rise to, no? So that give rise to, no, materiality, mentality, then we can get rid of the wrong view that we are created by an almighty God. No such thing as a creation by an almighty God. All our natural process, no, you can know that. So then we say, you know, you can get rid of many wrong views, no? So we say, no, like the view of uncausedness, ahituka deity, no, thinking there's no cause, no, for the rising of the living existence. And then there's the wrong cause of existence, visma ahituka deity. Not taking that, no, in the living, an almighty God created the living being. And then the view of inefficacy of, no, the action. So akiriya deity, though you perform, no, action, you think no karma produce. And then view of nihilism, thinking that, no, though you perform meritorious deed, no good effect, no, will come to you. And the view of eternity of the soul or ego, thinking that the soul is not always permanent, not sastra deity. And the view of annihilation of the soul or ego, uchida deity. So they think that when a person dies, everything is finished. No, so all these wrong views can be getting up, so we get, no, the purity of you, deity, visuti. And we also, no, overcome all the doubts, so we say, purity by transcending doubt, kanka vitana visuddhi. No, so the landmark of, no, this the state of purity is yatha bhuta jnana, the knowledge which can discern the reality correctly, or patya prika jnana, the knowledge which can discern all the causes of materiality, materiality. Then if you come to this state, you become a junior stream winner. No, so in a real stream winner, no, the wrong view, deity and vijikicha are totally eliminated. Now you have eliminated them temporarily, so we call them a junior stream winner. Then you can undertake vipassana meditation now. So we can go to the next paragraph. So maybe that topic. So, no, so purity of vision or discerning the part and not part. So now we go to the fifth stage of, no, the purity of the mind. We already, no, get rid of the purity of you, number three, and then overcome or transcending all the doubt, number four. Number five is purity of vision, no, discerning the part and not part. So, no, actually we start undertaking vipassana only at this stage. So we develop, no, samasana jnana, and, no, which is the knowledge that can investigate the three characteristic marks of mentality, materiality, Three characteristic marks means anicca, dukkha, anatta, remember? And then also we develop uddiyabhijñāna, the knowledge that can discern arising and passing away of ultimate mentality, materiality. So with three characteristic marks. So we say, strictly speaking, Vipassana Bhavana, which is investigation of three characteristic marks of mental immateriality, in the 31 planes of existence, begins at this stage. So, and then we go to the next page again. So the next page, please go ahead and to the next page. Okay. So we above this. Now we say, the so a little, maybe the next one. Okay, now I think 19, no, not yet. Kankha Vijana method. So below this. This paragraph. Now, for those yogis who have systematically investigated the five groups of existence in the present life as well as in the past life, the future life, and characterize each type of materiality and mentality and also mental factors and consciousness by means of their the characteristic function and the manifestation and then approximate causes, so they and also have correlated the ultimate realities according to the law of dependent origination. They can vividly see the long chain of arising and perishing of mentality, materiality, phenomena. So extending from the earliest part of past life, they have investigated to the subsequent past life and to the present life and then to the future life. Since they can see the arising and perishing of individual mentality, materiality, they can easily meditate on three characteristics of existence. So according to the experience of power forest meditators, yogis mean meditators. So the long chain of arising and perishing of mentality, materiality is so distinct that just by watching the arising and perishing of the mentality, materiality, they can undertake anicca nupassana. When you are reciting anicca, we call it anicca nupassana for 30 minutes. And then again, you descending, and then you're reflecting, dukkha, painful, or suffering. We call dukkha nupassana for 30 minutes. And again, by way of the anatta nupassana. That is meditating not self for 30 minutes. As they keep on meditating and rotating anupassana in time, their ability to investigate three characteristic marks of nama rupa so become better and better until they are able to see the arising instant, the existing instant, the perishing instant of each mentality, materiality. And this is the culmination of Samasana jnana. So then as they keep on meditating again on this the three characteristics, and they also they meditate on the causes and the effects of mental materiality, and then they pay more attention to arising and perishing instant, as they, you know, then they can find that, you know, they can meditate the arising instant and the perish instant of mentality materially very distinctly. So the arising of perishing phenomena of mentality and materiality, no, become very distinct when the knowledge known as Udayabhayanyana, no, so arises in him. So at this stage, Upekilesa, we say, no, 10 in, you know, impurities of Vipassana arises. So no, it is very a good landmark in Vipassana. No, when you come to this stage, no, usually this 10 impurity will arise. So obasa, very bright body rays will arise, no, in you. And piti, very great joy also arises. And pasati, no, very, no, the peacefulness and tranquility, quietude will arise. Adimokha is strong sadha, faith and, no, the faith and confidence in the Buddha arises. Pekaha, your effort of undertaking meditation is very, very great. Sukha, you know, so, no, very, very high, no, the bliss will arise also, and your, you know, meditation insight, wisdom becomes very quick, and upatthana, your mindfulness is also very, very great. And then number 9, no, upika, tranquility, no, so you become, no, you enjoy here, no, the equanimity. And no, the so very, very, no, quietude. And then Nikanti is my attachment to Vipassana Jnana, which is accompanied by joy, and then, no, the quietude, tranquility, no, bliss, and then the body rays. So among these 10, no, impurities, no, the 1 to 9, they are, no, the good, beautiful, no, the mental factors, and then also body rays, no, that arise, no, along with the Vipassana consciousness. And then only this Nikanti, no, is craving, no, is the real, the real, no, the we say, no, the defilement of the Vipassana, no. But when we, no, the meditator, they get, no, the great bliss and the body rays and all this, no, all these things. They think, no, most, no, some of them, no, they enjoy this, no, this great bliss and peace, no, with craving, and then they think that, oh, then they arise only in me, I exist, and they arise in me, so that is wrong view. And then, no, they yet exist only me, not in others, so that is a conceit. So when the, no, we say, no, the craving, and then wrong view, and mana, conceit arises, they are real defilement, no, defilement of kilesa. Some yogis with poor knowledge of Dhamma even think that they attain, no, mat, mega, and pla. So, no, mega and pla. So that means, no, they have the path consciousness and the fruition consciousness, and they even realize nibbana, they think that. So, no, such people, no, all these people, we say they have a wrong view and a vicious, no, pride, so on the attachment, the wrong path. No, there is the wrong path. So those people who have sufficient knowledge of Dhamma, not just like you have listened to my talk now, then you know that, no, these phenomena of, no, the body rays, joy, happiness, etc., just, no, the upekilesa, no, the upekilesa, no, the, and then they are not the right part. They are, no, they are not the right, the wrong part. They are, so, no, to be on the right part, one must meditate on the rising and perishing of the mental materiality in terms of 3 characteristics. So this knowledge, which can differentiate between the wrong path and the right path, is called Mega Mega Jnana Dasana Vichwaji. And the yogi who possesses this knowledge is said to attain the purity of vision, discerning the path and not path. So Now we go to the number six now, the six. So, come to the very good, he says, and, okay, should I stop or so what? Okay. Then we go to the sixth day, purity of knowledge and vision of the path progress. So now, no, they are free from, no, impurities of Vipassana, so they can undertake, no, the Vipassana, no, they are reflecting on three characteristics, and, no, they can discern the arising instant and the perishing instant together with the three characteristic marks that is called the Uddiyabhyanyana, no, become mature. And then the next knowledge is Benga Jnana, the knowledge of discerning the rapid and incessant dissolution of mentality, materiality. You keep on meditating, your inside knowledge becomes stronger and stronger, and you can see the arising and perishing of mentality, quicker and quicker. Remember, mentality, materiality arise and perish very, very rapidly at the rate of, not say 1,000 billion by snap of the hand. We cannot see like that. But when you can see very quickly, you cannot see the rising anymore. Only the perishing you are seeing. So at that time, whatever you see, all perishing, in all 31 planes of existence, all living beings, only material are perishing. So we say you attain Benga Jnana, the knowledge of discerning the rapid and incessant dissolution of mentality, materiality. And then as you keep on meditating, this, no, the perishing become, no, more and more, no, quicker. And when they become, no, so, no, the very, very quick, they are, no, everything you are looking, no, they are just, no, the, no, the perishing, then we say you attain Payanyana, the knowledge discerning the dreadful nature, the dreadful nature of mentality, materiality. So mentality, materiality, as all of them are just perishing, all what have you seen. So they appear, so the fear nature of mentality, materiality will appear. So then we say you attain Vipassana. And then when you attain, this Vipassana, you also see the force of materiality that is called Adinava Jnana. And when you see the force of materiality, you become disgusted with this materiality. At first you think they are very pleasant. Now perishing so fast. And they appear like fearful nature. So you become disgusting with them and become fed up. So you develop Nibbana Jnana, the knowledge of feeling bored and disgusted with formations as they are known to be faulty and unsatisfactory. Then the knowledge of the desire to attain liberation from all formation, mean materiality, mentality, arise in you. So just as the fish in the net of the fisherman and the little frog in the mouth of the snake want to escape, so mukchintu kamanya ta jnana mukchintu Kamyata Jnana, the knowledge of the desire for the liberation from all formations arises in him. So, to attain liberation from all this, the mentality, materiality, you come to know that you have to undertake the meditation again, more strenuously. And that knowledge is called Patisankha Jnana, the knowledge of exertion, exerting effort for the deliverance from all formation, by the investigating them and by reflecting them, now the three characteristic marks again. And then we say after that, no, so not before that, yeah, we have. So pratisankhanyana, no pratisankhanyana. So it's the knowledge of exhaustion for deliverance. No, so and when you are exhausting that, so the when you try to meditate very, no, the strenuously, and very soon you will come to the state. No, we call sankharupikanyana. No, the knowledge of equanimity towards all formations of materiality in the 31 planes of existence. So when you arrive at this this state, you can develop equanimity towards mentality, materiality. And then you have neither disgust nor attachment to mentality, materiality anymore. So you can keep a balanced mind. No, and even though you are seeing the true nature of mentality arising and perishing very rapidly. So now you come to the state that you come to know that actually do not exist. And this mentality, materiality, this is there, not nature, to be arising, perishing all the time. No? So no, it has nothing to do with me. No, I do not exist. So no, these are all things are not just the natural phenomena. So when you can develop like that, you enjoy the equanimity. You enjoy equanimity. And then we give you an example. So a man who has a very beautiful wife. So who marries a very beautiful wife. So we think, this man is very lucky. But the wife's beauty attracted the attention of other men, some of whom went out of their way to use every means to win her love. So if she was not faithful, and if her mind is not very firm, she might commit adultery. Now this man's wife was not faithful. She went out with several men, and her husband was very unhappy and pleaded with her not to be faithful to him. She refused to comply. She kept on going on with other men. So the man was so upset. So he couldn't bear anymore. So he divorced her at the court. So after divorcing, the lady would be going out with several men. Though he knew about that, then he didn't become upset anymore because she is not concerned with her anymore. No, that is a state. And then, as this man has already, not yet, not as he has already, this one, sankharupekanyana, anulomanyana, we go this one. So now, as he had already, have seen, have wished to escape from the entanglement of mentality, materiality. So now, though he was meditating, keep on meditating, his mind is always on the lookout, on the lookout for Nibbana. So when he could not see Nibbana yet, so his mind would come back. So we come to here. So his mind will come back to the mentality, materiality again. And again they have an example again. They say, in the old days, those sailors, when they went on a voyage, their ship go on voyage, they usually brought along several crows. So after traveling the several days, they expect to see land, but they don't see land yet. So they set free a crow, in the direction, the ship is sailing. So the crow will fly as much as it can, and then if that doesn't see land, it will come back, and it will rest on the mast of the ship. So the sailors know, the bank is not near yet, so they keep on sailing again. So after 2-3 days, they set free a crow again. Now if this crow see the land, it will not come back. Then they know that, the land is very clear. So they sail on and they left, they arrive at the shore. So we say the yogi who maintain equanimity towards mentality materiality and conditioned things carry on his meditation on the three characteristics of existence by way of three anupasana. And then, however, his mind no longer wants to observe the conditioned thing. His mind is looking out for Nibbana, and so long as it does not find Nibbana, it keeps on observing the conditioned thing. When it finds Nibbana, however, it departs from the conditioned things and enters the realm of Nibbana. So at that time, we get the next topic. So here already. So now when he got that, so we say he goes on to Nibbana the mega witi, the part. No cognitive series arises at that time. So in the teaching, we have taught you about the part cognitive series. So when you can develop the ten inside knowledge, this part cognitive series will arise in you. So if you are the slow-witted person. So now the part consciousness will arise like this. So now as you are reflecting on three characteristics marks, so one characteristic mark will appear in the mind door. Then the Bhuinga Jalana, Vengu Pachida, vibrate 2 times and cut off. Mano Dwara Vajana, will take notice of that consciousness and decide whether it is good or bad. Then Mahakusala Jnana Samyutta Chaita functions as the neighborhood, the Upachara Samadhi, Samadhi Jhavana Chaita arises 4 times as Prikama Upachara Nuloma Godrabhu. Then after Godrabhu, Megha Chaita, the part consciousness arises 1 time, followed by 2 fruition consciousness. So the cognitive series finished. And then if he is a quick-witted person, so pre-karma is omitted, so after mega phala, mega 3 phala chaita arises. So the person now becomes a stream winner. So we explain below this. So pre-karma is preparation for the arising of mega. U is upachara, proximity of karma. And nu is anuloma, adaptation or the connection. So the inside knowledge associated with this pre-karma, upachara, anuloma is called anuloma jnana. Number 10, vipassana knowledge, anuloma jnana, we also call it conformity knowledge. So it is the highest, the part wisdom. And then after that, Godrabhu, though it is Mahakusala Chaita, it takes Nibbana as object. So we say it is the consciousness that casts the body lineage to form the noble lineage, to form the noble lineage. So in the above cognitive series, Prikama Upachara, so already finished here. So the Godrabhu is called the knowledge which cuts the walling lineage to form the Ariya lineage. So Godrabhu takes Nibbana as its object. And as soon as the Godrabhu perishes, the part consciousness and fruition consciousness, they arise taking Nibbana as their object. So the Megha Chaita, though it arises just one, No, it is very powerful. It simultaneously accompanied four functions, namely comprehension of the noble truth of the noble truth of suffering. So he already see all five aggregates that make up the body, and they are considered mentally material, rising and perishing very rapidly, and they really are amounts to suffering. And then number two, eradication of craving, which is the cause, the noble cause of the cause of suffering, not the noble truth of the cause of suffering. So the Buddha said, the craving is the cause of suffering. So now, you can eliminate the craving, which is the noble truth of the cause of suffering. So and then by eliminating it means extinction of the cause of suffering, and that is also the realization of Nibbana, and that is the third noble truth. And then the fourth noble truth is, now you know that the Eightfold Noble Path is fully developed, so that you already realize Nibbana. So we go to the next. So now we say, Pachvekana Jnana. So review consciousness. As soon you attain the Megha Chitta and Prusian consciousness, after they arise, then followed by this, Pachvekana Jnana. So by this, the knowledge, you develop the wisdom that review the path that you already realize. And then the fruition, now you already you can enjoy it. And Nibbana also you have seen, you have realized it. And the defilement which have been eliminated, and the defilement which have been still remaining. So that means if you attain the enlightenment and get realization Nibbana, by this fruition attainment you can know yourself that you become enlightened as a noble person. And also we say, if you are a noble person, you can enjoy the bliss of Nibbana by fruition attainment as much as you like. So now altogether, we have to develop 16 knowledges to attain Nibbana. So what are they? So we begin with the Nama Rupa Prichida Jnana, the knowledge of karita rising or defining mentality, materiality. And then also the Pachya Brigha Jnana, the wisdom of knowing the causes of materiality. And then we develop 10 Vipassana Jnana, and then Gotabu Jnana, Megha Jnana, Phala Jnana, Pachvekana Jnana, all together 16 consciousness. So when you attain the first part consciousness and its fruition consciousness, so you become extreme winner. So Sotapatti Megha Chitta, it totally eliminates the wrong view and vijikicca, skeptical doubt. And also it also eliminates the gross parts of the remaining defilement that can condition you to be born in a bhopo state. So that means when you become the extreme winner, you will never be born in a bhopo state again. So all the bhopo doors are closed for you. And then you can enjoy the taste of Nibbana as much as you like. So if you undertake Vipassana again, you can attain the higher, the three, the path wisdom and fruition wisdom. Even if you don't undertake any more the meditation, and if you just like to live with it as a stream winner, you can live with your family and enjoying sensual pleasure and as well Nibbana pleasure, and you can live even up to seven existence in the sense sphere. And then if you you like to, you can also be born in the Brahma realm. And finally, you will be automatically, you will attain the higher Megha and Phala, and you become an Arahat, the highest attainment in life, But we say, even if you attain the, you become a noble person, the first, the noble person, we call three winner. So you already, had attained the best attainment. So we have the saying, So far better than having sovereignty over the whole earth as a universal monarch, and far better than to be the king of the devas, that rules 2,000 sarem and the 2 celestial realm, is to become a stream winner and to enjoy nirvana forever and to become enlightened finally as a rahat, that is the perfect noble person, and that is the highest attainment in life. So by undertaking the samatha meditation and vipassana meditation correctly as taught by the Buddha, so now you can realize the highest attainment. So you can live happily forever. May all of you attain may all of you undertake vipassana correctly, and may you attain enlightenment and become noble person in this very life. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Not 10:30 yet, so you can ask questions if you'd like to.
Thank you, Dr. Mon. I think it's very enlightening, isn't it? I think it's so fantastic. We have Siale Dipankara that day, talking about Nama Rupa. And then today, Dr. Mon even gave us a more profound teaching about the Abhidhamma. How what is about Samatha and Vipassana? And what is the proper way, to get into the path? That is so important. But anyway, if you still couldn't understand, you can go to this book at chapter number 9. Okay, you keep on your check. What he was reviewing is all in the chapter number 9. You can get hold of this book and can read again. Yeah, we can have a Q&A. Is it okay, Dr. Mon? Are you okay for Q&A? If anybody want to do any Q&A, questionnaire? Yes. Oh, thank you. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. So, if anyone any question you would like to, ask, yeah, please, yeah, can come here.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Yes, we can be very late.
It is very late. Okay, then we will end of this these sessions, and Dr. Mon, can you lead for transfer and share the merits? I think it's great. Yeah, I think it's so fantastic.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. No. Imaya dhammanu dhamma patipatiya buddham bujimi. Imaya dhammanu dhamma patipatiya dhammam bujimi. Imaya dhammanu dhamma patipatiya sangham bujimi. With our holy practice, which is in accord with the 9 supramundane dhammas, we pay obeisance to the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. Idam me punyam asvakaya vaham hotu. May this merits of mine lead me to the extinction of all defilements. Idam me punyam nibbanasa pacheyo hotu. May this merits of mine be conducive to my attainment of nibbana. Imam na punya bhagam sabha saddhanam dema. Imam na punya bhagam sabha saddhanam dema. Imam na punya bhagam
Sabha Saddhanam Dhimma. We share our merits with all sentient beings. May all sentient beings obtain the share of our merits and be well and happy always. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. So if you have recorded this Dhamma talk, then you can spread it and let others listen, whoever like to know about meditation. Okay. Sadhu.
We have done this recording. We will put up in the YouTube once we have done some editing, yeah. And then you can listen again and listen again, yeah. That will be fantastic. Okay. Good night for everyone. Yeah. Oh, some sorry. Yeah. Yeah, and I would like to you all to help us to stack up the chairs together and put it from the side to the web. Yeah, it'll be thank you. And we have some cookies down there at the ground floor. It's a beautiful cookies, and I wish you all a happy new year. Yeah, thank you.